Good morning, students. Hope you all are fine. So we started with chapter 5, that is working of institutions. So I gradually moved on to explain you that how is a decision taken. That is how the government takes decision, what are the procedures that needs to be followed. Then we talked about who are the decision makers, that is who takes this decision. Is it a single person or a whole group? That is it a person or a body that comes together to take a decision? In which I also explained you about what is a reservation, because the example that was given is all about reservation. And then I came to the topic need for political institutions. So which are the primary institutions? That is legislature, executive and judiciary. Why do we need these institutions? We talked about this. Then in detail we discussed about parliament, and then of course why do we need a parliament, that is why and what is the purpose of the legislature, who is the final authority for making laws in the country, is it the same all over the world or not, and who controls over the finances. So we talked about this. After that I discussed about two houses of parliament, that is Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha, wherein I explained you that this is the lower house and this is the upper house, and don't go by the nomenclature or the segregation, the lower house or the upper house. If we talk about which house is more powerful, of course it will go with Lok Sabha. It is not that Lok Sabha is not needed, but more power has been given in the hands of the Lok Sabha. Why? Because it is a directly elected house, that's why we the people directly elect the members to the Lok Sabha. After every 5 years, the election to Lok Sabha is held. So because it is a directly elected house, the house becomes more accountable and answerable, and therefore the house has been given more power in comparison to Rajya Sabha. So then we discussed about political executive, wherein I told you what is the difference between political and permanent executive and what are their duties. The last topic that I could do in the last video was Prime Minister and Council of Ministers, wherein I talked about three important rings. That is, this is what was I explained, that the heart is PM. The closest ring to PM is Cabinet Ministers, who are given the important ministries or portfolios. Then we have Ministers of State with independent charge, and then we have Ministers of State. So today I will start with powers of the Prime Minister. Of course, Prime Minister is the leader of the majority party that scores the maximum number of votes and forms the government. So in this context, the Constitution does not say very much about the powers of the Prime Minister or the ministers. Much has not been written, but whatever the tradition we have seen and whatever the powers have been excluded by the Prime Minister and the ministers, keeping that in mind, we could sum up that what are the powers of the Prime Minister. So of course you would be remembering this, that he is the head of the government. So if he is the head of the government, major function is performed by the Prime Minister. He has wide ranging powers. He chairs cabinet meetings. That is, whenever the cabinet ministers, they meet to discuss on certain policy issues, that cabinet meeting is headed by or presided by the Prime Minister. He coordinates the work of different departments. So he looks into the mutual coordination or understanding between different ministries and departments. His decisions are final in case disagreements arise between departments. Say there is a clash between Ministry of Health and Sanitation and Ministry of Water. Okay, maybe there is a dispute between them on certain policy issues. So where will they go? Will they go to Supreme Court? No, this is an internal matter and this has to be solved and looked into by the Prime Minister. Until and unless it is a gross violation of law and order, they need not go Supreme Court. He exercises general supervision of different ministries. All ministers work under his leadership. The Prime Minister distributes and redistributes work to the ministers. He also has the power to dismiss ministers. When the Prime Minister quits, the entire ministry quits. So he supervises that whether all the ministries are working properly or not, and he gives them portfolio and can also take back the portfolio, allot them other portfolio. He assigns them work and looks into that whether the work is being duly performed or not. If a minister fails to perform his functions, if a minister is not dutiful, then he has all the power to dismiss the minister. But the bottom line is, if he himself quits, the entire ministry quits or will have to leave. He is the leader of the majority party. And if you remember, Council of Ministers are collectively responsible to Lok Sabha. So this collectively responsibility means we are working as a team. So if we are together, we have to work together. That is, Lok Sabha sings together. So if Prime Minister is leaving the institution, the other ministers would also quit. Thus, Cabinet is the most powerful institution in India. Within the Cabinet, it is the Prime Minister who is the most powerful, because he is the head of the Cabinet meetings. He is the head of the government. The powers of the Prime Minister in all parliamentary democracies of the world have increased so much in recent decades that parliamentary democracies are sometimes known as prime ministerial form of government. The parliamentary form of government gives immense power to PM. So now it is equated, or it is also called as prime ministerial form of government. Political parties have come to play a major role in politics. The Prime Minister controls the Cabinet and Parliament through the party. So he is controlling the Cabinet and of course Parliament, because if he is the head of the government, the Parliament, the laws are being made by the ruling party. I won't say the ruling party, the laws are being initiated by ruling party. At times any member can introduce a bill. But the point is, the major say is of the person or is of the political party that has formed the government. Opposition cannot do much other than offending what has been, other than opposing what has been said or what the bill has been introduced. And that is what done. You see, any bill that is introduced by the ruling party, be it abolition of triple talaq, be it revocation of special status, Article 370, Jammu and Kashmir, be it Citizenship Amendment Act, what have they done? They have only criticized the policy. So this is what they do. Now the media also contributes to this trend by making politics and elections as a competition between top leaders of party. So if you see, media makes it a face-to-face competition, that is one-to-one. So if you remember, in 2019 election, it was not specifically a competition between BJP and Congress. Other parties are actually redundant nowadays. We have only two major parties. At national level, we talk about multi-party system. But if you see, we are only talking about BJP and Congress at times. No other national party has a major role to play. Even if they form government, they will of course be in coalition. So that in 2018, it was a face-off between Rahul Gandhi and Mr. Modi, and not BJP and Congress. So if you see, this important role was played by media. In India too, we have seen such a tendency towards the concentration of powers in the hands of the Prime Minister. Jawaharlal Nehru, the first Prime Minister of India, exercised enormous authority because he had great influence over the public. So it also depends on the leader, like Mr. Manmohan Singh. Of course, he was a statesman, an intellectual person, but he could not leave that mark among the people, or he could not create that impression, because he was not very vocal. He is a very refined orator, but if you compare him to Mr. Modi, he was unable to reach the masses. Of course, he could touch the classes. To reach the masses, you have to leave an impression, you have to be close to them. So it also very much depends whether you have that art. That also matters. Whether you have that art to leave an impression. Like Indira Gandhi also, she was very close to masses. So if we see, Mr. Narendra Modi is also the same. So that is what, the extent of power depends on the personality of the person who is holding that position. However, in recent years, the rise of coalition politics has imposed certain constraints on the powers of the Prime Minister. The Prime Minister of a coalition government, that is coming together of two or more parties to form the government, if any single party is not able to score the or secure the number of seats required to form the government. So because it is a coming together, so it is not only that one party has formed the government, so then he cannot become so independent, and then he cannot take decisions as he likes, because then he has to accommodate the ideology and views of all the parties that have come together to form the government. So of course he needs to listen to them. The next is the president. So I have already told you so many times, Prime Minister is the head of the government and President is the head of the state. In our country, or according to our constitution, he is only the nominal head. He is like the Queen of Britain, that is the monarch, whose functions are to a large extent ceremonial. That is, actually, he is only there to hand over the appointment letters, to sign the agreements, to receive the diplomats. So he supervises the overall functioning of the political institutions in the country, so that वो लोग आपस में harmony में काम करें, and thus they are able to achieve the objectives of the state, that is to work for the welfare and development of the country. He is not elected directly by the people. It is an indirect election. That is, all the MPs and MLAs, they come together. That is an electoral college. The group of MLAs and MPs, they elect the president. So we elect MPs, we elect MLAs, then they elect the president. So it is called as an indirect election, because people directly don't participate in the election of the president. A candidate who is standing for president's post, he has to get a majority of votes to win the election. So इससे क्या होता है, that he is representing the entire nation. MP हमने elect किया Lok Sabha election में, MLA हमने elect किया State Legislative Assembly election में. तो indirectly हमारे representatives ने president को elect किया. तो president, of course, because he is not elected directly, he cannot claim the direct popular mandate that can be claimed by the Prime Minister. क्योंकि Prime Minister को तो हम ही लोग elect करते हैं. आई मीन लोकसभा इलेक्शन में हम पार्टिसिपेट करते हैं, और लोकसभा इलेक्शन में जो पॉलिटिकल पार्टी का जो भी लीडर होगा वही लीडर प्राइम मिनिस्टर बनता है. बट प्राइम मिनिस्टर को तो बट प्रेसिडेंट को पीपल तो डायरेक्टली इलेक्ट करते नहीं है. दैट्स वाई ही ऑलवेज रिमेन्स अ नॉमिनल एग्जीक्यूटिव. एंड द सेम इज ट्रू ऑफ द पावर्स ऑफ द प्रेसिडेंट. इवन इफ यू कैजुअली रीड द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन, आप देखेंगे कि देर इज नॉट मच दैट अ प्रेसिडेंट डज. सिर्फ जितने एक्टिविटीज हैं वो उनके नाम पे होती हैं. That is, the bill is passed, वो president के पास जाता है, the moment the president signs, it becomes an act. Has he any power to return the bill? He can once send the bill back for recommendation. But recommendation के बाद जब वो वापिस आता है, he has to sign, he is bound to sign. All major appointments are made in the name of the president. He does not decide, he just hands over the appointment letter. These include the appointment of Chief Justice of India, judges of Supreme Court and High Court, गवर्नर्स ऑफ द स्टेट, इलेक्शन कमिश्नर्स, एम्बेसडर्स टू अदर कंट्रीज. ये सब सिर्फ अपॉइंटमेंट लेटर इज हैंडेड बाई द प्रेसिडेंट, द डिसीजन इज नॉट टेकन बाई द प्रेसिडेंट. ऑल द इंटरनेशनल ट्रीटीज एंड एग्रीमेंट्स आर मेड इन द नेम ऑफ द प्रेसिडेंट, एंड द प्रेसिडेंट इज द सुप्रीम कमांडर ऑफ द डिफेंस फोर्सेज ऑफ इंडिया. बट ही एक्सरसाइजेज ऑल द पावर्स ओनली ऑन द एडवाइस ऑफ द काउंसिल ऑफ मिनिस्टर्स हेडेड बाई द PM. Yes, he can ask the COM to reconsider the advice. But if the same advice is tendered again, he or she is bound to act according to it. So he is a nominal executive. He is a ceremonial executive. He does not have much power. I already explained about this, that if a bill is sent back, he can only once send for reconsideration. But if the parliament sends back the bill in the same form without any changes, then also the president is bound to now sign it. Now you can think, what can he do on his or her own then? He appoints the Prime Minister. That is what. But he only hands over the letter to the Prime Minister. Where does he perform a role? Say, any party or any coalition party is unable to secure a clear majority to form the government. Then the President has to appoint the leader of the majority party or the coalition that enjoys majority support in the Lok Sabha. But when no party or coalition gets a majority support, then the president exercises her discretion. Discretion matlab mera choice. To phir president ko apne opinion mein jo bhi lagta hai ki ye party given time mein majority muster kar legi, majority number of votes collect kar legi, ya logon ki majority hasil kar legi, majority support in the Lok Sabha, matlab aapas mein milke ye wo utne coalition ya gathbandhan ki sarkar milke wo utne seats jod payenge, then he asks such person, or he hands over the appointment letter to such person, and then he gives him a certain time frame that you prove majority in the Lok Sabha within a specified time. The last institution is the judiciary. So first thing I'll explain you, India has an integrated system of judiciary, that is, see, it is pyramidal in structure. It is not that these are segregated. At the bottom level, of course, we have district courts, you all must be knowing. Then state level we have high court, and at the apex we have supreme court. So it is connected. If you don't get justice here by the means of appellate jurisdiction, that is by the means of appeal, you can climb the ladder of judiciary. So if you remember what had happened in that Mandal Commission case, when reservation was passed, people went to judiciary to see whether it violates Article 14, 15 and 16. So we have an independent and powerful judiciary. Why independent? Because if we don't keep judiciary independent, it would always work under the political pressure. And we don't want that to happen. That's why, you know, maybe appointment letter is handed by the president, but the removal of the Chief Justice of India or judges of the Supreme Court and High Court is a very cumbersome process. It is actually impeaching the president. The process is the same. That's the reason, because if the process is kept simple, they will lose their independence. And then they will always work under the control and fear of political leaders. And then the essence of democracy somewhere would be eroded. All the courts at different levels in a country put together are called the judiciary. I have already talked about High Court in the state, Supreme Court for the entire nation, and district courts at the courts at local level. So we call it as an integrated judiciary. What are the cases that can directly be taken to Supreme Court? If your fundamental right is violated, you can directly go to Supreme Court. Okay, now see, it's given over here. Supreme Court controls the judicial administration in the country. The decisions are binding on all other courts because it is the apex court. So between citizens of the country, between citizens and government, if two states are in dispute, say there is a river which is a part of both the states, say for water sharing, that this Cusack of water goes to your state, it should the more amount should be given to me because the major part of the river is in my state. Say there is a dispute related to water sharing, it would be looked into by the Supreme Court. And between governments at the union and state level, that is a clash between state government and central government. It is the highest court of appeal in both the cases, civil cases and criminal cases. And of course, I talked about appellate jurisdiction. You, if don't get justice from High Court by the means of appeal, you can go to Supreme Court. And I have already talked about what is the independence of judiciary. That is, they are kept free from the clutches of political leaders so that they don't work under any fear. That is what is being talked about here. The judges of the Supreme Court and the High Courts are appointed by the President on the advice of the Prime Minister and in consultation with the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. The practice is that the senior most judge of the Supreme Court becomes the Chief Justice of India. Of course, there is very little scope for interference by the political executive, and it is impossible to remove a judge of Supreme Court or High Court from that position. It is as difficult as removing the President of India, and the process of removal is called as impeachment. The judiciary in India is also one of the most powerful in the world. The Supreme Court and the High Courts have the power to interpret the Constitution. This means that if a law is passed by the Union Government or the State Government, the judiciary has all the powers to determine that whether the law is against the constitutional norms or not. And if it is, if it goes against the principle of constitution, the law would be struck down and it would be called as invalid. This is called as judicial review. The Supreme Court of India has also ruled that the core or basic principles, which is called as basic structure of the constitution, this cannot be changed. That is socialism, secular, every word that is there in the preamble, that is the basic structure, and no amendment can change that. Why have we kept the judiciary so independent? Because then only it can act as guardian of the fundamental rights. So this is what is all in this chapter. I hope you people are clear with it. These are the words given in your book. Kindly revise it, learn it and write in your copy, so that you memorize it well. And then there are certain questions you need to answer. This, I mean, you need to answer this in your notebook. You'll find out the answers and you will write the answers in your notebook. Thank you. We'll meet again in the next lecture.